At the outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Rohit for giving me this talk. So dry eyes bring home as a specialty. This is the first, probably the first prescription for dry eyes, which was given 3,500 years ago. If a man's eyes are affected with dryness, he shall rub an onion, drink it in beer, apply oil to his eyes. Thou shalt disembowel a yellow frog, mix its gall in curd, and apply it to his eyes. This was 3 millenniums ago. I come from a family of ophthalmologists. My grandfather was from KGMC Lucknow, and then he worked in UK, and my dad studied in All India Institute. So I thought I'll ask my dad what was dry eye treatment 4 decades ago when he started ophthalmology and my grandfather was still practicing, to just get a perspective for this particular talk. And this is what he said. There was basically no concept of dry eye. Everything that didn't fit into anything else was labeled as dry eye. And anybody who had dry eye used to receive albucid eye drops, which is basically sulfacetamide. And somebody who had worse dry eye, which is not responding to albucid, would receive nafazoline. And the really bad dry eyes would receive glycerine drops. That's it. There was no tear substitutes at the time. So we obviously have come a long way since then. And that is why I think this talk, why a dry eye deserves to be a specialty, because of these 5 factors. It's a huge problem. It's multifactorial. We heard in the morning Sheetal talking about dues to. The definition itself has so many elements in it, so it encompasses a lot of things. We know the explosion of diagnostics that's available. You go outside in the trade and you can see. And therapeutics, we'll just touch upon that. There's been an explosion of research, good quality research, which is helping us take proper decisions. So we all know that dry eye is very common. Almost half the people in the world have dry eye. And we know that older people and women are more prone. It has a huge economic burden because of the size of the problem and the cost of treatment. Especially in developed countries, the treatment of a dry eye disease patient, definitive dry eye disease patient in Japan, is $6,000 per annum. And a probable dry eye disease patient is $2,500 per annum. That is huge. And almost 40 to 60% loss of productivity while working in the United States. I'm sure if we extrapolate, it would be similar figures in India as well, although the economic impact would probably be lesser, but then the per capita income is also lesser. Our lifestyles are changing. We're looking at electronic gadgets all day. We're wearing contact lenses. We're having refractive surgery. So, and this is only going to increase. So if you're worried about the prevalence of dry eye today, what's it going to be in a decade or 2 decades from today? Just the artificial tear industry is $2 billion. $2 billion, that's a staggering amount. And this is just artificial tears. There's so much more in dry eye treatment. This tells you 2 things, not just the size of the problem of dry eye, but also the fact that we really don't have a good tear substitute. And that is why you have so many options, and that's why it's such a big industry. We know that it's a multifactorial disease, and we heard about this definition in the morning, which includes the key components of tear film instability, hyperosmolarity, surface inflammation, and damage, etc. We know that the classic dry eye is the aqueous deficiency dry eye, keratoconjunctivitis thicca, and it may be associated with Sjogren and rheumatoid arthritis and other systemic diseases. These are the undoubted dry eyes, and you know what to do. But in spite of all your treatment, they are very difficult to treat. We know all that. But I think the more common dry eye that we see in the clinic is the lid margin related dry eyes, be it anterior blepharitis or posterior blepharitis. Evaporative dry eye is really a huge volume of dry eye we see, and we all know that these patients have more symptoms than signs. And they are the ones which are often difficult to treat. So these are the common things, but there are many other things which come into dry eye. For example, we have some less common conditions that we see, like the mucus fishing syndrome. I'm sorry, let me go back. Why is that magnifying lens not coming? Yeah, sorry. So you can see in this area, this infranasal staining. This is very classical of mucus fishing syndrome. So some patients have this habit of putting their finger into the eye, or they fold a handkerchief and use the corner to keep removing discharge. And that causes this kind of a staining, and you can see that SPK is in the cornea there. And if you don't look carefully, you can miss this. You can call them conjunctivitis or allergy and keep giving them lubricants and steroids. But till they stop putting the finger in the eye, it's not going to get better. And if you don't know this condition, you won't be able to treat it. So it's important to know all these other things that also can be a cause of or can be because of dry eye. SLKC, superior limbic keratoconjunctivitis, is another very often underdiagnosed entity. You can see this classic corridor of congestion at the top, and often associated with thyroid. Problem there is of conjunctival redundancy. Another very common condition in India is vernal keratoconjunctivitis. At summertime, we know all our clinics are filled with these patients. And chronic surface inflammation, not just with this or with any cicatrizing disease, damages the goblet cells, damages the ductules of the accessory lacrimal glands, and also in Steven Johnson, it damages the lid margins, so the meibomian glands get blocked. And so basically, your aqueous, mucin, and lipid components of tears are all damaged. And these are really the bad dry eyes to treat. Another underdiagnosed entity is conjunctivocalasis, in which you have these folds of conjunctiva. They not only interfere with the movement of tears, so causing tearing, but they also, because of the friction with each blink, there's a lot of irritation and discomfort to these patients. And all it needs is a small surgical treatment. You have LASIK-induced neuroepithelopathy, which has SPKs like this, and you can keep giving them all kinds of things, but unless you understand what it's because the nerves have got damaged while making the flap, you're not going to be understanding what's going on. So that's just some of the conditions that encompass dry eye. There's so many more. Just to touch upon diagnostics, classically we use Schirmer's and tear film height and tear meniscus and staining patterns. One of the useful things are these questionnaires that are available to understand the severity of dry eye, to quantify the disease, and probably understand where in the spectrum of dry eye it is. I think the simplest test in the clinic that you can do is the tear film breakup time. It really helps you understand what type of dry eye you're dealing with and how bad it is, and even for conditions like refractive surgery, whether to go ahead or not, this is probably one of the easiest tools. And this, I think all of us must pay attention to. This is again another very nice diagnostic tool which is available to us now. We all have infrared cameras even in outer F. And this is my meibography, and you can see that my right eye is worse than my left eye. You can see the meibomian glands are not as good. And my right eye does irritate a lot more. And if you see my own lipid flow, which is basically a measurement of our interferometry to understand our lipids, you can see that the tear has better lipids in the left than the right. So this was an eye-opener for me that I also have this problem. And what was most surprising for me was actually this. You can see the number of partial blinks. I blink only one complete blink out of six, and here only three complete out of 11. So I'm a partial blinker, which I didn't know, and I think very few machines can tell you that. So this has a high-speed camera, which can pick that up, and it can do an automatic analysis and tell you. And I think that's a great thing, because this is something we don't look at. And it may answer a lot of unanswered questions, why some people have dry eye in spite of everything else being normal. We all know that tear osmolarity is one of the central things in the definition of dry eye, but until this machine came, there was no way of really measuring it in the clinic. You could do it in the lab. And so I think it's good that these kind of equipments are available. Once they become cheaper, I think that will really be very, very useful. There's been explosion in therapeutics. We used to first treat dry eye with bottles like this called collyrium, in which you used to pour like a borate solution into that cup, which used to fit on top of the bottle, and you used to dip your eye into it. Now we have screw cap bottles from which you can deliver drops, and now you have special bottles like the Novelia, in which the preservative-free drops can be kept without getting contaminated. Mm-hmm. So we've come a long way from, in the 80s, we got the first HPMC with BAK, then we got second-generation lubricants, we got hyaluronic acid, preservative-free lubricants, and now we also have lipid emulsions available. But just teardrops is not the answer. We have to give a lot of other things, mucin secretagogues, anti-inflammatory treatments, ointments, and sometimes you have to do procedures like punctal occlusion, lipid flow, and in bad cases, even a salivary gland transplant. So this is something which has now recently become available here. NN has it for a while, but now Abbott has acquired this, so more of us have access to it, and probably it's going to get cheaper, is the lipid flow, which is basically a very expensive way of doing hot fomentation and lid massage. But it works. This is my own brother who has evaporative dry eye, and he really found a huge difference. The question is, how long will it work and how many times you need to repeat it? There's been an explosion of research. After the NEI report, the number of publications doubled. After DUES, it doubled again. And I'm sure after DUES too, it's going to probably quadruple. Yeah. One very good example of high quality research in dry eye is the recent meta-analysis, which showed that omega-3 fatty acids don't work. And we've been burdening our patients with these tablets for years and indefinitely. Yeah, and right now we know because of that meta-analysis that it's probably not worth increasing their
economic
burden.
Goes forward and
so does dry eye deserve to be brought home as a specialty? An emphatic yes. I think the time has come. I'll just leave you with these few images. This lady, Rose Lynn Fisher, she was a photographer.
This can be pointed
she
in
decided
any direction.
To do photographs of her tears after putting them on a slide. Just like we do the Ferning test, she looked at her tears in different emotions. And I thought this was quite interesting. I found this while I was researching on Instagram.
I don't want
so
no
tears
pointers.
From laughing no until pointers. You cry.
So I'll keep it simple for the audience.
Tears from elation at a liminal moment. Tears of redemption, that looks like a classic Ferning test. Tears of compassion. Tears of being overwhelmed. Tears of timeless reunion. Tears of beginning and ending. Thank you.